everyone. Thank you very much for joining us at this session on creativity. This session is called the Creative Carousel. It's a format that we've done several times in the past, and it basically just means you're going to take a bit of a ride focusing on the important topic of creativity. But I'm the Chief Executive of Thinkbox. We are here to help everyone get the best out of commercial TV. And so it wouldn't be a Thinkbox presentation if I didn't do a couple of slides first. But they do have a point. You'll have seen this one already. For anybody who was at this event yesterday, this demonstrates that TV accounts for 71% of all the profit generated by advertising. So of all the profit generated by advertising, TV accounts drives 71%, and at an incredibly high ROI. Why am I showing that today? Well, and why are we focusing on creativity? Because creativity is a massive driver of effectiveness. And analysis of the IPA Effectiveness Databank has proven that if you can get the creative right, it improves the efficiency of driving market share by up to 12 times. So, you know, even average TV works brilliantly. If you get the creative right, it can work 12 times better than that. And what are the key drivers of effectiveness? Well, it's also proven that it's fame and emotion. So if you can focus on making your brand famous, if you can do it with a high degree of emotion, those are the most effective drivers. It doesn't mean that sort of persuasion and information campaigns can't work. It's just that the ones focusing on fame and emotion tend to be the absolutely most effective. And the single most important, the best predictor of in-market effectiveness is actually likability. So, you know, it outperforms every other metric in terms of sort of predicting in-market effectiveness. So creativity is incredibly important, and we have got an amazing panel here today. You are extremely lucky, and I feel very privileged that they've all said yes. So starting at my left here, we have Ben Tollett, Group Executive Creative Director of adam&eveDDB. So Ben and his partner Emma were the ones who basically created the famous John Lewis campaign that you we have come to know and love and anticipate every single Christmas. Ben is the person responsible for that. He's done a whole load of other things, of course, as well at Adam and Eve, yeah. But I think that's the thing that will, that's the thing you'll be remembered for, I think.
I suspect,
so
yeah.
That's your appalling legacy given to the world.
Thank you.
Anna Balarin, Executive Creative Director at Mother. She started her, I didn't realise that she started at Mother as an intern in 2007. How amazing. And now you are ECD, which is incredible. Mother just have such a strong heritage of incredible creative work. Sometimes slightly out there, sometimes a bit alternative, and they really make a fantastic contribution to the whole creative landscape in the UK. And finally, we have Nils. Leonard is the founder of Uncommon Creative Studio. He is the sort of hot, I suppose not so new startup now. Sort of how long has it been going? Year and a half?
Yeah, we're just over a year old now. Yeah.
Yes, and has already had fantastic success with an ad that I'm going to show you later. He's got a D&AD pencil just 8 months after the studio launch. So, you know, doing really well. So what I've asked the panel to do today is prepare a series of ads to talk about. And we're going to do this through the lens of the future of TV creativity. What does the future hold? You know, how has it changed? You know, what shall we do about looking to the future? So I've asked them to prepare a home ad each, so one that they've done that they're particularly proud of, an away ad, something that they're bitter and twisted and jealous about that somebody else has done. We thought we'd have a quick look at this year's Christmas TV ads, and we'll have a conversation about the latest crop. And then finally, present an ad that you think gives an interesting insight about the future of creativity. So should we start on the home ads? So first of all, I'm going to ask Ben, why don't you talk about your choice, first of all?
Yeah, so I'd like to talk about an ad we did recently for Marmite. I don't know if anyone here isn't from the UK and isn't familiar with Marmite. Hopefully most of you are. It's a savoury spread that people either love or hate. And this year we thought it would be very exciting to make the brand famous again by creating a gene test. So it's not strictly a TV idea first and foremost, we actually created a real genetic test where people could find out whether they were lovers or haters. This test was sold on the Marmite website. It's very expensive.
Literally,
I think it still is sold on the Marmite website, if anyone's interested. I think it retails at £80 plus. So
you haven't sold
we didn't sell too many test kits, but we did sell a whole heap of Marmite off the back of this. So the film I'm going to share, I guess it kind of lies at the intersection of sort of biotechnology and breakfast stuff.
Okay, so, brilliant. Let's play Marmite, please.
Yes! They're here!
This should be interesting.
Please find enclosed the results of your family's recent Marmite gene tests.
These show whether you were born a lover or a hater.
What does it say?
You're a hater.
Dad.
Yeah.
I need to tell you something. I'm a Marmite lover.
I thought you said I hated it, and this says I love it. What type of mother does something like that?
But baby,
Oh my goodness, I am so stupid.
I prefer jam.
I'm carrying a hater's baby!
You basically took my childhood!
Oh, sweetheart.
Come here, son. You didn't care.
No, we just want you to be happy with who you are.
Have you ever done it here? In this house?
Yes.
I only do it to make you happy.
Do I look happy?
On this table?
Yes.
Ah! Baby, please, Dad!
I don't hate Mum, I hate you!
I can learn, look.
Get in, all lovers.
Oh, I hate it!
He's never even tried it.
Anyway, so tell me about it. How did it go?
Well, it went brilliantly. I think we probably sold about 8 gene test kits, but the sales of Marmite obviously went through the roof because it was a very likeable, talkable, shareable ad, and the whole concept grew from this film. It was covered on Channel 4. It became part of programming. It was on Sky News. All the main media channels picked up on it, and it became a national talking point.
It's quite a risk for a brand to dramatise something which is essentially a negative about it, isn't it?
So, yes.
Loads of people hate this stuff.
Yes, what that's you're right.
Really, so was that difficult to persuade the client to go for that?
Well, I mean, absolutely fantastic clients at Unilever who have been running with this idea that you either love or hate Marmite. For many years, for well over a decade now. So actually, they are fully behind it, embrace the idea, recognise that it creates a point of difference in the market, and are exploiting that with great ideas like this one every year.
Fantastic. Right, Anna, your turn. What have you got to share with us today, your home ad?
I've got also a love it or hate it scenario, but it has to do with Turkey. I guess based on an insight of people actually having to pretend they love Turkey for Christmas. So this is our KFC ad for Christmas this year.
Let's play it.
Thank you.
to put literally a chicken and remind people of what it is that,
yeah,
they're eating.
Absolutely, and a risk for a client that's had, by all accounts, a very difficult year with the chicken crisis earlier on, and they stuck to it.
Beautifully exploited in advertising, of course.
And but the first time we put the live chicken on air was actually last year, beginning of last year, and that caused a big, huge controversy, mainly from vegans, I guess, which was expected. But funnily enough, this time around, there wasn't. We didn't get a lot of negative reaction by showing the chicken on TV. And we suspect is because there's a very strong narrative at the core of this ad. So it grabs your attention, it creates intrigue, it takes you throughout. So there's almost like people felt that there was a reason for the chicken to be there alive.
Now both of those are funny ads, you know, the humour is at the heart of them. And I don't know, this is just anecdotal, but it feels like there are fewer funny ads nowadays.
Yeah.
So why are people not writing funny ads anymore?
I blame you.
The John Lewis effect.
you think that's what it is?
Yeah, quite possibly. I think it is very hard to do, to make people laugh. Actually, it requires a very high level of skill, amazing writing and performance and great direction.
So every element has got to be right.
Yeah, and of course, if you're trying to make a film or a TV spot that does create emotion, raise some emotion in people, sometimes it's easier to go for a different emotion than the laugh. It's easier. The gag is actually quite hard. It's an emotion to raise. It's actually sometimes easier to make people, well, sometimes cry.
I mean, I think the same is true in TV programming as well. Yeah, comedy is notoriously hard to get right.
So. Yeah.
Right, Nils, what have you got to show us?
Yeah, I spot for OVO. This is just like a hate ad.
Yeah.
No, but I think it's interesting. I think one of the most underrated emotions to cash in on is frustration. I've always believed that. I've always thought that frustration as an insight was really, really interesting. And the other thing, we were sort of talking backstage about television in general. Television at the moment, right, you watch programmes and it moves us on. It shows us people we don't currently see in the world and it tells us what the world looks like. It's kind of like a mirror. All this stuff going on about the environment, about politics, whatever, and then suddenly the ad break comes on and sometimes just pretends that isn't happening. And I guess just from our point of view, we were very passionate about trying to work with brands and not do that. How incredibly fresh it would be to have a brand cash in on all that stuff. So OVO came to us and they said, we'd like you to help us sell our energy against the Big Four, who are famously very safe and very, even their body language is very, you know, friendly. It's all kind of lens flares and everyone in kitchens hugging. You know, meanwhile, actually, all the energy we use, of course, is making an impact on the planet. And so we wanted to make a bit of work that just said, actually, you know, you can change all the energy we use in all these places just with a phone call. But the reason why you should do that is, of course, that people, you know, who aren't us are making decisions on our behalf about the future of the planet. So we made this.
Climate change.
Global warming is not happening.
There is no such thing as a climate change.
Severe weather warnings for the UK.
Where is your evidence of global warming?
They are pulling out of the historic agreement.
I don't want you to protest. I don't want you to riot because I wouldn't know what to tell you to write. All I know is that first, you've got to get mad.
I want you to get up now. I want all of you to get up out of your chairs. Go to the window, open it, and stick your head out and yell, I'm as mad as hell, and I'm not going to take this anymore!
I think it's got a brilliant audio in that ad, hasn't it? The way that it builds to a climax and the combination of the music and the voice. How much was that planned beforehand?
Yeah, loads. We had Trump in that for months in a rough cut, you know, because this guy just pulled out of the Paris Climate Agreement. And, you know, there were people sat in this country, I don't know, you know, the makeup of the audience, but there were people sat in this country going, what is this guy doing? And he's, you know, and he was kind of going, you know, climate change, oh, it's all a hoax. And we were like, fucking hell, we're staring at this situation. So we had him in there, and then what we realized, though, is if we just played in the negative, you can't go anywhere, you couldn't move anybody, and everybody wants to act and wants to do something. So we found the speech from Network, the 1960s film, where he says, I'm mad as hell and I'm not going to take it anymore, and whack that on the end. We had the sound bed for a long time, though, and I think that's another thing maybe a lot of people don't do with TV, is that it's very much idea-centric, and then we all get in an edit suite and freak out about the music. We try very hard.
You've done plenty of that in your time, haven't you?
Yeah, right. And, but I think where possible, get to something, because music is a shortcut for emotion, right, and all of that other stuff.
Yeah, brilliant. And so all those ads, has the process of creating changed over the last, over the course of your careers? Is it different now, or is it still fundamentally, is it sort of two people sitting in a room together? How does it actually work?
I guess it's still the same. Yeah. I wouldn't say two people, more than two people, several people.
Okay.
Yeah.
So it's a bit like a sort of, American TV writer's room type approach.
I don't know. The way I only ever worked with mothers, so I can only vouch for the way we work, but we normally get everyone, so the planners, the creatives, and everyone, project managers involved, and obviously the idea will come from a creative team with the informed from the planners, but everyone has a say and input. It's not an isolated process, and with the clients' collaboration, of course, throughout. But the process, essentially, it is just the same. It's people sitting down, writing ideas.
I'd just love to lob something in, though, which is, I think I'm very chuffed to be sat next to you two, but both of you have really clear creative agency standpoints on the world. Okay, and I think the one thing that has gone a bit missing in our industry, and I only say this because I've started, is a viewpoint from the companies that we run. What's our take on brands? What's our take on the impact we want to make in the world? Because when you're in a room, particularly in a pitch environment, you're all doing the same stuff, and no one's thick, right? We're all really bright people. So the only thing you have is the way you view the world. Mm. And I guess that I just think that's something that I was talking to someone recently, and they said, actually, technology, new channels, all of this change, the difference is how you see the world way before you get into any of those. Okay. And I think that's something the UK should bear in mind more.
So actually, you shouldn't start with the technology, start with the philosophy.
Yeah, what's your view on all this?
Yeah.
What do you think about, there's been so much change in creative agencies recently, hasn't there? So, we've got two new agencies. We've got VML, YNR, and we've got Wonderman Thompson. Mm. That's clear. There's a massive changing of the guard, isn't it? At least at WPP. So what are your thoughts about that?
It's funny how it's talked about in the media often in quite a negative way, I feel, whereas actually I'm very excited by the change. I think it's healthy and refreshing and energising for the business that we've got, changing of some old agencies, trying to reconfigure and become new, and that's exciting. And at the same time, we've got lots of small agencies, places like Uncommon starting, which are going to add great vibrancy in the independent sector. So I think it's a fantastic, vibrant time.
A lot of people have said it will. They fear it will impact on creativity because it's a more sort of direct, short-term focus being applied to those companies. Would you agree with that or disagree?
I think it's simpler than that. In that, what are you about? I think it's never been clearer to see the companies that are about creativity and the companies that are about other stuff, and they're both valid. Mm. But I think that the one thing I would say about WPP's current direction is that I don't think it's marketing to creative talent as much as it's marketing to different talents.
Okay.
And I think that's fine. I just think we've all got to stop acting like it's going to impact on creativity. We're still going to need creativity more than ever before. Mm. But I just think you've got to be clear about what it is you're making.
Okay, brilliant. Right, let's move on to your away ads. So what did you choose? We'll start with you, Anna. What did you choose of work that you particularly admire from someone else?
I chose this year's Christmas ad from Boots. And
oh, no, we're on Away.
Away, so, yes. Sorry.
We'll come on to that.
Yeah. Away, I chose a 3Mobile ad this year, which I thought was an amazing, a brave thing for a company as well to take a stance against a trend that phones are bad, but also do it on behalf of the whole sector, just on behalf of themselves, which you rarely see these days.
So it's like a sort of category growing.
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay, so can we play the 3 ad, please?
bad.
All the generations end humanity.
It's all bring about the apocalypse. Life was better.
Life was better without phones? Really?
Connecticut! Sir, I've got the test! Hazard ahead!
Oh gosh, best avoid that. Turn left.
That could have been a disaster.
Phones 1, haters 0.
Group photo. Another group photo. Which one is she?
Phone save wise.
Eat this apple, for it is delicious.
Sound good.
What?
Need more proof? Okay.
An idea that turned into a dream. A city that became an empire. Without a leader, Rome will fall.
Oh, 56 endorsements for leadership.
Rome is saved.
Believe this. Even better on the best network for data. 3. Okay.
Brilliant, isn't it? Brilliant. So I'm interested that because they're not the biggest player and yet they're the one doing the sort of big category job. So what are your thoughts about that? Is that appropriate for a small brand to do?
Yes, absolutely. That's how they're going to get seen and heard. I think it's just amazing. The amount of craft and, the narrative and the high entertainment stakes of it. And they managed to do, they're almost competing with themselves in that ad because they want you want, when you have an ad on TV, to get people's heads up from their phones. And there's something very meta about that because they're talking about phones and trying to get your attention from away from what they're talking about.
Away from that screen, it's a brilliant way to do it though, isn't it? Yeah, fabulous. Right, next up I think, Nils, would you like to go next with your choice?
Oh yeah. Nike Londoner. I mean, I don't know. Do I need to even talk about it?
Should we play it and then you can riff a bit? Nike Londoner, please.
I've had the longest day, man. You said you were going to come to me, now you're telling me to come to you. I'm not getting on a cycle.
Cycle? That's light work. Man's got to run 2 miles from Ed just to get to training. Serious, bro?
2 miles? Really? I have to run all the way from Zone 6 with my school bag!
Oh, you think that's tough? I have to run through Peckham at night!
What's wrong with Peckham?
Well, I gotta fight these waste man just to play. This is my multi-purpose. Hats for running, football, tennis, basketball, court,
You don't know the meaning of fighting. I have to fight my whole family before I even walk in the ring.
That's nothing. In my family, if you're not in first place, and you're considered a
failure. No, man, you're begging it. I've got more chance of getting hit by lightning than going pro. It's mad.
Perfect. Are you serious? I've got to get to the biggest game of my life, score a
people. Lucky.
No one plays ice hockey in London. I have to be my own team.
My own opposition.
And my own coach.
Yeah? Yeah?
Well, I have to run to training, coach my own coach, carry my whole team, and the best mate. What would the world be?
No, no. Huh? Morning.
Oi, Mo! Ever play tennis in London?
That's easy. I only get one try to land it. Before getting caught by security!
Yeah?
Well, I've got to be my own security, cuz.
So, if this goes wrong, I'll break my leg!
What? Even when I win, I get a broken nose!
This is London.
It is brilliant. You sort of think when Nike get it right, they get it really
it's
right,
ridiculous.
Don't they?
It's ridiculous. Like the music, the energy, everything about it, like the body language of that, way before you even get to the insight, is incredible. You know, if you're watching that next to another ad, you're just like, what the fuck's going on? Also, they're huge. And yet the insight is really local, you know, and I think that's super rare as well. I just thought that was incredible.
But I think the boldness, the ambition of it, just, you know, what the hell, we'll have all of that and then more. It just is, you know, it's an amazingly indulgent thing to do, but brilliant. Right, I need to move on because we've got a spectacularly interesting thing next, Ben, of your choice, which is, this is not something that's been on TV yet, here. I'm not even sure if it would go on TV yet, but tell us about it.
Yeah, so I believe this is aired in Scandinavia, but it only came out in the last week, so it's fresh off the blocks. And the reason I wanted to share it today is because I think we're coming to the end of the year, and I kind of expected all the films that I saw at the moment to be about Christmas and festive ads and family and friendship and comfort, and then I saw this and it just, I mean, people often say that a great idea sort of hits you in the stomach, like you really feel it in the stomach, but this almost just knocked me sideways. It's absolutely terrific piece of film, beautifully shot, incredible track, and it's so uplifting and joyous and it's very special.
Okay, let's play it.
Afraid to say I love you, afraid to take and too eager to give. You help me deal with what I'm feeling, with why.
So as we speak,
we come a long, long way together, babe. Through the hard times and all the good. Take this day to celebrate you, baby. Cause I have to stop and praise you like I should.
What the?
We come along. You're so rare.
You're so fine.
I'm so very glad you're mine. You're so rare. So rare. And you're so very mine.
I had to bring a new life.
that you like then.
Yeah, sitting here as a middle-aged guy, I feel like it's a little, probably looks like a little bit of virtue signalling, doesn't it? But it's just it so joyous and uplifting, yeah. And it takes you on this, it's perfectly executed, yeah. From the track through to the...
Every styles, the animation and the live action.
Yeah, it's very pointed. It's got a real strong point of view. It's very challenging, actually. I find it quite difficult to talk about in some respects, which is, you know, perhaps a function of being my Britishness and perhaps our coyness about talking about the body. But yeah, I find it almost overwhelming as a piece of creative filmmaking. It's superb. Yeah.
It's brilliant. It's so interesting, isn't it, that a category like that, which was derided by the ad industry for years, has now sparked this whole series.
I was just going to say, I think that someone talked about this the other day to me, and they, you know, God, it's so brave, right? And bravery is this thing everybody talks about all the time. But if you think about it, it's not massively brave, because, you know, staying like we are, we're just going to get skipped. Mm. Staying like we are, people are going to keep staring at their phones, like you say, you know. And I kind of feel like, actually, to the point of that, or London, or any of these, where you take a chance, you have to. Mm-hmm. There is no other choice. So I kind of look at that and go, it is absolutely just brilliant. But I'd love us all to believe it wasn't that brave, that it was just the only logical option in an age where technology is making it possible for us to skip what we make.
I think it's a great example of advertising potentially changing culture. You know, if that were able to be on air, it normalises everything and it stops it being a sort of embarrassing topic.
Yes.
And brilliant. Yeah. Anna, any thoughts from you on that?
I love it.
It's Kim Gehrig, isn't it, the director,
who
did the Sport England fantastic work.
Yeah.
Brilliant. Right, we're now going to have a little detour onto Christmas. We're going to just present a couple of the this year's Christmas ads, which I asked the team to look at. So, Anna, do you want to go for yours?
Finally.
Yes, here we are.
Yes, Boots. And this is more commentary rather than... I wouldn't call it my favorite ad of Christmas. I think it's just a comment on what we touched on earlier of the John Lewis effect, that you amazing legacy and you'd be super flattered that everyone's now trying to do the John Lewis ad. And I can see clients asking agencies, I want my version of the John Lewis ad. And it's just a bit sad that, no, you're not going to get a John Lewis ad because you're not John Lewis. Yeah. And it's the clients and agencies should be trying to carve their own spot in the Christmas scene. Mm. And I think Boots, it's a perfectly nice ad, and there's nothing wrong with it. But I think it's just, and this is one example picked at random from multiple, that everything, especially at this time of year, it's starting to look a little bit the same and go a little bit safe, which...
Okay, can we play the Boots hand, please?
Does my hair, well, she tries, massive smudge round her eyes. If there's somebody biting her tongue, she's me mum. Somebody spoiling my fun, she's me mum. Did you see standing there by the tree? Now I can see her stunning and strong. She's me mum.
Boots, let's feel good.
You see the. Please do. Still makes me feel emotional there. I think it, you know, as a mother of daughters, it definitely resonates. I think it's Yeah, so it's a homage to you, Ben. the next one we have, yes, why don't you tell us what's the ad you're going to share? What's your Christmas ad?
So actually, I was going to bring the John Lewis ad, but I suspect most people have seen it. So and you may have seen this one as well, but I thought it'd be nice to share. It's an ad for Waitrose, and it's a very simple idea that the food is so good that you can't wait to eat it. And the team came up with this lovely thought that perhaps the food is so good that you might even want to skip the John Lewis ad to get to the food, which I think is quite. I just love the self-referentialness of it. The fact that we're actually able now to write what I think is quite a funny little spot about missing what is essentially a piece of event advertising, the John Lewis film.
Let's play it.
Guys, it's the John Lewis advert. It's really good to see. You're going to love it.
Oh!
That's good. Faster. Faster.
It's maxed out. There. Stolen.
Good idea. I love their ads.
So emotional.
Get me every time.
I prefer the one with the penguin.
Yeah, I think that's ridiculous. You're punking yourself.
Yeah,
fuck's sake.
It does, doesn't it? But I think it's good also because the viewer can share the joke. Mm. You can only do that on something that the viewer is so familiar with that you know, they get it. Otherwise, it would be straight over their heads. So,
yeah.
Nils, what about any comments on either of those?
No. No, I think it's amazing. I think it's amazing that you can punk yourself. I think we should never ever question the power of British creativity or what we can do because of what these guys have done on that.
Mm.
I am sick of it.
Yeah.
And want it to change and want a different energy and a new comedic value and a irreverent thing to happen, but massive respect. I mean, I think that there are people at the best brand building agencies in the States looking at that going, fucking hell, that's next level, I think. So well done to you.
It's interesting how sometimes, like sheep we are as an advertising industry, rather than sort of thinking, right, I'm going to do, I'm going to invent my version of John Lewis, you try to do a sort of slightly similar version of what already exists. And actually, in a creative industry where everybody's trying to stand out, why does that happen so much, do you think?
I think, sadly, it is human nature to crowd together. We are like herd animals, aren't we, much of the time? And it takes the sort of outliers, which I think often creatives are within agencies, to go, actually, you lot are all over there thinking one thing. I'm just going to go off and have a little explore around the corner where I think there might be something else that's a bit fresher and a bit different and bring that back.
Do you think, one of the big changes in the industry at the moment is technology? You know, we spend an awful lot of time talking about it, and, you know, it's changing very fast, and there's a lot of energy and excitement around that. Is that bringing great creative possibilities as well? You know, what is the impact of all the technological changes, both in, you know, the way TV is delivered, the possibilities of, you know, online TV?
I think it's changing the delivery very much. Ads are much more targeted these days. We can pick our audiences more carefully. But actually, in terms of our roles as creative, I mean, I don't want to speak for everyone, but I don't think it's my role has changed very much in the last 20 years. Like, the canvas that we work to for us is still the same. It's still trying to put a great idea into an audiovisual piece of film. Whether that's 5 seconds, 10 seconds, or 2 minutes, and so technology isn't really affecting that side.
Okay. Anna, any thoughts?
Yeah, I absolutely agree. Although you can be ultra targeted, you're still delivering something which is a content, and that needs to be good. If you can target someone, but if you're not showing something that they want to watch or are interested in, what's the point?
Yeah.
Okay. Great. Right. We probably don't have time to do all of these. I asked a panel to look at, give me something about that's an interesting comment about the future of TV. So anybody have a particularly strong feeling that they'd like to show one of these?
Well, Yeah, all right. Yeah, a little bit. I don't want to show you the trailer. We haven't got time for that. But.
Oh, no, but we should.
Okay, come on then.
Can we show the Hannibal trailer, please?
Allegro mi sembrava amore, tenendomi il cuore in mano. E nelle braccia aveva Madonna involta in un trappo tormento. Dante's first sonnet. It fascinated Cavalcanti. The eating of the heart is a powerful image.
Where is he?
You let him go.
I've killed hardly anybody during our residence.
You are going to be caught. It has already been set into motion. There is only one way you will forgive Will Graham.
So everyone's talking about the role of technology in terms of brands, right? And I think there's a lot of conversation around the fact that technology currently is serving an old value, which is it's still trying to force-feed people with messaging they necessarily don't really want. This is an interesting story. I just thought basically, they were going to commission Series 3 of this, and NBC, apparently, I'm going to get all the stats wrong, but apparently they need 1.3 million eyeballs on every episode to guarantee commissioning a series. I had this idea, I was like, right, and I tried to drum up the money to buy the series. And the thing I wanted to do for the third series was drum up the dough and then go, right, we're going to produce a series like you want to produce it. We're going to make the show that we always make. Because my theory was this, okay, Hannibal's only getting 800,000 eyeballs on it, but they fucking love it. They don't quite like it. These people love it. And I was like, okay, what if we bought it, we made the series for them, and we do the same thing we always do, but we also make and commission 15-minute cooking episodes with Mads Mikkelsen. Every one of these. Hannibal in the kitchen, right? And I was kind of like that, you know, and you would pay for that deeper content. People would pay for it because they love it. Whatever. The point is that I think brands can look at all of this completely differently, which is we're looking at television advertising going, how do we innovate and force-feed people with more stuff made by us? I'm like, how do we enrich a viewer's experience and how can brands play a part in that? Mm. And there's an example like this everywhere. And I kind of just looked at that and went, with all the technology we're hearing about now and all of those incredible targeting and personalization, all that other stuff, how do you take things that people are actively hunting and love and supercharge that versus the stuff that they don't love?
Okay, brilliant. James, did you want to just ask your question?
I think you've actually answered the question.
Yeah, that was actually quite a good lead-in, wasn't it? Yeah.
First of all, thanks.
I always tell I've got that big booming voice, I don't need a mic, but anyway, here I am. I'm just blown away by the work, and it's a reminder, actually, why we all got involved in the advertising world in the first place. I mean, just amazing work, and listening to what the panel have to say about the interaction between technology and creativity. That was the question I was going to ask, but you've actually answered it already. Mm. I think there's a real need to put the technology into the messaging. You know, there has to be a way of embracing technology, as opposed to just, as you said, Nils, force-feeding people with information or messaging they don't want. And I think you're showing us examples of why good creativity touches all of us. And I think that's been inspiring. So thanks for remembering that I had a question, but that was it. And you already answered it.
Sorry. All right.
Brilliant, absolutely brilliant.
That feels to me like a very good place to stop. Please join me in thanking our fantastic panel.